All right, let's talk about question three. In part A, we see this specific format of the matrix called H hat, or something like the Hamiltonian operator, and that this specific format of the matrix H hat in the form ABBA provides us some kind of information about a particle in a quantum mechanics system. So assume that we know A is larger than zero and that B is larger than zero. We want to derive some kind of further condition about the contents of H hat such that the eigenvalues of the matrix is always non-negative, which means it could be larger or equal to zero. Now that we kind of understand what the problem is asking about, let's go ahead and try calculating out. In order to solve part A, what we'll need to do is to calculate the eigenvalue of H hat in terms of A and B. And so then we'll be able to derive some kind of equality or inequality such that the eigenvalues are again forced to be not negative. Here's a few reminder on how to calculate eigenvalues, is that we try to determine some numbers lambda such that the determinant of h hat minus lambda I is equal to zero. More specifically, in the format of h hat, we'll be calculating the determinant of some kind of matrix like this, which, according to the formula of determinant, we can say is equal to the square of a minus lambda minus b squared. And again, we say that this is equal to zero. This means that the eigenvalues of such a matrix H hat could be either a minus b or a plus b. So we know that since A is larger than 0 and B is larger than 0 according to this given condition we see in the problem, A plus B has to somehow also be larger or equal to 0, because that's just what the given conditions would imply. So we more so have to worry about case 1 rather than worrying about case 2. And in this case, to ensure that A minus B is larger or equal to 0, we can do some algebraic manipulation and then determine that if A is larger or equal to B, then A minus B, which is equal to one of the eigenvalues of the matrix, must be larger or equal to zero, which means this eigenvalue is non-negative. And then coming back to case two, we know that case two, which is the second eigenvalue, has to be positive anyways. So we get that the condition, and the only condition, such that both eigenvalues of this matrix H hat is forced to be non-negative, is that A is larger or equal to B. So that's part A. Now let's look at the second part of the question. In the second part, we are told that Mickey has this other H hat matrix, which again has this unknown content, and that Mickey has successfully gotten the eigenvalues of this H hat matrix. So then we're supposed to derive the contents of the matrix. But fortunately, with the work we've done in part 3a, we know that the eigenvalue of H hat actually has to depend on the content of H hat, and furthermore, we already have these two formulas regarding how the eigenvalues of H hat should be. So in this case, lambda 1 should be the smaller eigenvalue, which means it's supposed to be a minus b, because a minus b is supposed to be smaller than a plus b. And that is again because a and b are both positive, which is given in 3a. Alright, so in summary, we say that lambda 1, which is equal to, again, a minus b, according to my previous work, is equal to 5 over 2. And lambda 2, which is equal to a plus b, is equal to 9 over 2. Now, to solve for A and B, which are the contents of the H-hat matrix, we just need to solve this system of two equations with two unknowns. Thus, A should be equal to 7 over 2, and B should be equal to 1. Alright, now we have one last part of the question. And so in this part, part 3c, we're given this new matrix H-hat, which now has a very concrete content, it's 3, 2, 2, 3. So it has two eigenvalues, and for each eigenvalue, it has another normalized eigenvector. And at last, we are given this state vector Vs, which is equal to 0, 1, such that it's some kind of linear combination of the two normalized eigenvectors. And so now we're asked, what is the magnitude, or what is the absolute value of alpha, given that alpha is this coefficient in the linear combination that the eigenvectors form. So, in order to know how to build this kind of linear combination, we should be knowing what the eigenvectors of this H-hat matrix is first. So let's write again what H-hat is in this case, which again is 3, 2, 2, 3. We know that the eigenvalues of H-hat should be equal to A plus B and A minus B. So in this case, it will be 1 and 5 respectively. So now let's try to calculate the normalized eigenvector of each eigenvalue. First, let's calculate V lambda 1. So I'm supposed to know that H hat minus lambda 1i times V lambda 1 is equal to 0. And H hat minus lambda i1 would look something like 2, 2, 2, 2. Because I'm subtracting the diagonal of H hat by the eigenvalue I'm working with, which is 1. This empty bracket here is my representation of V lambda 1, and we know that by multiplying this matrix with that vector, it's supposed to be equal to 0. Let's just write V lambda 1 here instead, which is better for the mathematical representation. So here I know that V lambda 1 is supposed to be some kind of constant times maybe 1, negative 1, because you see that 1, negative 1 belongs to the null space of this H hat minus lambda I, lambda 1i matrix. And this can be either done with Gaussian elimination, or you can just do some mental math and figure this out. But in order to make V lambda 1 normalized, we should first try to figure out K1. So we know that the magnitude of this vector 1, negative 1 itself should be root 2. If we divide this vector by its norm, then it will make the norm of this new vector normalized, which will be 1. So then I get the result that V lambda 1 is equal to 1 over root 2 times 1, negative 1. To make a vector V normalized, let's just write that down here so we get clearer with this. Divide this vector by its norm. Alright, so that's the calculation for V lambda 1. And the calculation of V lambda 2 would apply the same logic, except we'll change some parameters in our calculation. In this case, since we're calculating for the case of the second eigenvalue, we have this new equation that H hat minus lambda 2 instead of lambda 1i times V lambda 2 instead of lambda 1 is equal to 0. Now let's try to find this new matrix, and in this case I subtract the diagonal of H hat with my new eigenvalue, which is 5, and so I get a matrix at negative 2, 2, negative 2. And again multiply this by V lambda 2 to get 0, which means V lambda 2 again is belonging to the null space of H hat minus lambda 2i. Again, via Gaussian elimination, some algebra, some linear algebra, or some mental math, we'll be able to get that V lambda 2 is equal to some kind of constant times this vector 1, 1. But what is this K2? Well, again, let's look at the hint we wrote below before, which is that to make a vector V normalized, we can divide V by its norm, such that now its norm is 1. And the definition of normalized is that a vector's norm is 1. So in this case, K2 will be 1 over the current norm of 1, 1, which is root 2. Now I have both normalized eigenvectors. I try to solve the system that Vs is equal to alpha times V lambda 1, which is known now, plus beta times V lambda 2, where V lambda 2, again, is also known. Vs is also known. Well, let's try to write this system of equation out in the matrix vector form. And maybe things will get slightly clearer. I should get something to the lines of this. And here we're just writing out all the vectors that are known. These two equations are still trying to tell us the same thing. But what's different is that now we can translate this set of equation into a matrix vector multiplication. So we're back to the scope of midterm 1, and we get this matrix vector representation that is equal to 0, 1, which is Vs. So to solve for the magnitude of alpha, we need to know the absolute value of alpha. But to know the absolute value of alpha, we have to know alpha first. So therefore, we'll have to solve this system out. And let's try it out. So we know that 1 over root 2 times alpha plus beta is equal to 0. And 1 over root 2 times beta minus alpha is supposed to be 1. I will add these two equations together, and then I will get that 2 over root 2 times beta is equal to 1, which is also equal to root 2 beta. Which tells me that beta is equal to 1 over root 2, and since alpha plus beta is equal to 0, I can then determine that alpha is equal to negative 1 over root 2. And thus, the magnitude of alpha, which is the absolute value of alpha, is equal to 1 over root 2. And then we're done with part 3c.